a flyer. I have to tell you, Gary, I got to tell you this. And I got to explain myself better on this. I made this statement. I've been making the statement that it's not a bulletin. Now, I need to clarify that. It starts with four letters, bull. Okay, so it's not a bulletin. That's the, so I want to clarify that. All right. So, but inside, you have your outline. And this week and next week are huge, huge messages. You really, really need these. I know I do. And I've been actually seeking something that I'll be talking about a lot within this week and next week. It's very powerful. You know, I often make the joke that in my last rocket science class, and the reason I do is because there's some things that I see in Scripture and I think, wow, God, if there's a blessing on this, then I'm going to go for it. Can I give you one? Just one. Look at this. Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. Watch this. Chapter 1, verse 1. Let's just do chapter 1, verse 1. Notice it says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now go to verse 3. So it's the revelation singular of Jesus Christ, not of what's going on in the Middle East. It's the revealing of Jesus Christ. It's redemptive. But that someday, I've been threatening. But blessed is he. I read this years ago, shortly after I got saved. I've been a Christian 32 plus years now. So I read the book of Revelation every month because of this verse. Because of this verse, and I have for years. Blessed is he that reads. I can do that. That hears. Well, I'm hearing better now what the book's about. It's about Jesus. It's the revelation of Jesus. It's redemptive. And here's the words of this prophecy. We know Revelation 19:10, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So it's about Jesus. And keeps those things which are written therein. The word keeps simply means to guard or protect. Okay? For the time is at hand, or it is near. It is nigh. The time is at hand. I could go into that, but here's my point. I'm not going to get into that. I want to make one statement as we prepare for this week's outline. In my last rocket science class, now, if God says there's a blessing on this, how many of you like to be blessed? I do too. So that's why I did that. And I've heard everybody and his brother's interpretation, you know, pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, no-trib, amillennialist, preterist, futurist, historicist, horistist, roristist. I'm a redemptivist. I believe it's redemptive. I believe it's about Jesus. I believe in the second coming of Jesus. But so often we focus so much, we make this book just about the future, that we miss what he did in his first coming. Like taking our sins, things like that. They're kind of important, I think. But anyhow, there's a blessing on this, so that's why I did that. Now here's another one, and this is going to prepare us for our outline. Go to James chapter 4, verse 6. James chapter 4 and verse number 6. Watch this. But he giveth more grace. Now the preceding verse was talking about the Spirit in us. The Holy Spirit through our born-again spirit lusteth the envy, the King James says, but he yearns for us. Let me say it to you this way. God wants you all to himself. Yes. Amen? See, we've made worldliness about what people do. It's not about what people do. It's about what's in their heart. Amen? People ask, well, can you have a Christmas tree? I tell them, I said, listen, unless you're having a problem with bowing down and worshiping it, have a Christmas tree. No big deal. It's not a big deal. But see, religion makes it a big deal. But God's interested in your heart. God wants you all to himself. I've said this many times. My wife and I, we have an agreement. We're not allowed to date around. I know. It's tough. But I work through it. You know why? Because we're married. But that's what God's comparing. In fact, James chapter 4, the same chapter, you back up to verse 4, and he says, you adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that trying to find your fulfillment outside of me is adultery? That's what he's saying. Okay, here's what I'm after. Go back to verse 6. But he giveth more grace. How many want more grace? Man, I do. I want more grace. I want grace in every area of my life. Well, there's a key to this, and that's why I've called this message, and it's a very important message, the key to more grace. Wherefore he saith, God, 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 Resist the proud. But he gives grace to the humble. Rocket Science 101. If God resists pride, but gives grace to the humble, I'm going after humility. I want to know what it is. I want to know how to walk in it. I want to know where pride is. The Bible says in Proverbs, I believe it's 16:5, everyone that is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Listen, it's not personal. Just like if you grab two live electric wires and you get electrocuted, it's not personal. It's not the electric come say, I'm going to teach him a lesson. He'll never do that again. It's just the laws. Amen? God resists pride. God resists pride. But he gives grace to the humble. Now, we're going to talk about this in a lot of different ways. Humility is not what the world says or what the church world has said. Oh, I'm just a nobody. That was a good message, brother. Oh, no, it was nothing. It was nothing. It was all God. It wasn't all God. It was me too. That's humility, what I just said. God uses us. We co-labor with him. See, we got this wrong idea of humility. See, I recognize that any good thing in me is from him. And the more I recognize that, the more I acknowledge that, and the more I depend on him, the more his grace flows. The less I think, ain't I something? God, you made a good choice when you picked me. The more I do that, the more God resists. Right. See, a lot of people are rebuking the devil, and it's not the devil.
There you go, bro. Amen. Amen.
It's God's resistance. This is what I say. This is so important. This is so necessary. But he giveth more grace, wherefore he says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace unto the humble. Look at the next verse. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. You know, pride is Satan's sin that started the entire fall. Did you know that? Satan says in Isaiah chapter 14, he says five times, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. I will ascend, I'll be like the Most High, I'll ascend above God, I'll do all these things. All right, go to your outline, and we'll go to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. 2 Peter and chapter 1 and verse 1. Look at this. Watch this. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 1. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. We have it. Next verse. Grace and peace. Grace and peace. Be added. No, be multiplied. How many know multiplication is bigger than addition? Right? Be multiplied unto you through something. Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ our Lord, right? Of Jesus our Lord. Grace and peace can be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Just like grace and peace can be multiplied, they can be subtracted, taken away from you, right? Now, Romans 1 and verse 16. And we're going to get into your outline just here in a minute. Jen told me to get right to it. She's right. For Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation, deliverance from the molestation of enemies. Salvation includes peace, it includes joy, it includes healing, it includes all those things. The gospel's the power. Say, the gospel's the power. Now watch this. Unto salvation, to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, which simply means that the gospel was given, Israel received the law, etc. But it's to everyone. Next verse. For therein, watch this, for therein, wherein, the gospel, is the sinfulness of man revealed. Did I say that wrong? Therein, in the gospels, the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. Number one knowledge is you got to understand that the gospel is about his righteousness. Now, go one more, Matthew 6:33. He's talking about all the things. What are we going to eat? What are we going to wear? All those types of things, the necessities of life. And notice what he says. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and whose righteousness? His righteousness. But notice what our part is. Somebody say seek.
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 Seek. the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things that we worry about shall be added unto us. One more. Romans 5:17. I've shared this one before, and then we are going to get to the outline. See, if I'm not seeking His righteousness, then I'm basing my life on my righteousness. I think I'm pretty good. For if by one man's offense, Adam, death reigned by one, much more. Somebody say much more. Much more. They which receive, present tense, continuous, ongoing action with no end in sight. The abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Christ Jesus. This is all part of humility. Humility's understanding that my righteousness is like filthy rags, Isaiah 64:6, but I'm seeking His righteousness. Amen? Everybody got that? Now, turn to your outline. The enemy of receiving God's grace is pride. You see that letter A there? The enemy of receiving God's grace is pride. What is pride? Romans 7:18. I'll show it to you. I'm going to show you pride. Here it is. Paul said, "For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, in my own strength, dwells no good thing." I know that in me, that's in my own strength. That's what that's talking about. Christ is in you, the hope of glory. So in Him, I'm strong. Okay? But in my own strength dwells no good thing. But see, a lot of people think God grades on a curve. They think God's, well, you know, you're pretty good. This is, I don't want to get political, but I'm going to for just a second. You know, the whole liberal mindset is basically that mankind is good. That's the core of it. You know, mankind is wicked without Jesus. That's the foundation of it. That man is basically good, and you can just have open borders and anybody can come in because everybody, love, we're all God's children. Nonsense. We were at the fair last year, and I was standing there, and somebody shot off some fireworks, and I said, "Do you realize how easy that could have been, gunshots?" Because man's wicked. Without Jesus, man is wicked. And see, that offends people. Are you saying that I'm wicked without? Yeah, we all are. I know, Paul said, that is in me, that is in my flesh, dwells no good thing. See, that's pride. Satan said, "I want to be like God. I want to do my own thing. I want to call what's right and wrong." See, that's the mindset. We're called, you know, the knowledge of the tree of good and evil. I determine what's good and I determine what's right. If I want to be married to five people, you don't have no right to tell me I can't be. Of course, my wife will kill me, but that's another subject. But see, that's what it is. Where does it stop? There's no standards. And what the church represents is there is right and there is wrong, and God's the one who determines that. Yeah. Amen? Oh, that's not great. See, people don't even know what love is. We think love is just love, tolerance. Go ahead. If you want to go into the bathroom, you mailman, where my little daughter's at, you go right ahead. It's okay. I have no right to judge you. We're commanded to judge people. Judge not according to appearance, but judge righteous judgment, Jesus said in John 7:24. We're commanded to judge people. Not pass sentence and send them to hell, but we need to be discerning, but our love needs to bound more and more in all knowledge and discernment. It says in Philippians chapter 1, I think it's verse 11. Somewhere around there. It's Philippians 1. Amen? But see, we think love is just putting up with all this stuff. That's not love. I love the scripture in Leviticus 19:17. You shall not hate your brother in your heart. You shall in any wise rebuke your neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. If I don't tell you, if I know something, if your zipper's open and I won't tell you because I'm afraid you'll get offended at me, I don't love you very much. Hey, your fly's open. Ooh, I thought I felt air. If you get mad, you get mad. Right? Because I love you. See, we don't even know. The whole society is redefining love. And there's no absolutes and there's no standards. That goes all the way back to the garden. You can be a God and you determine what's right and wrong. There is right and there is wrong. No, that's not grace, brother. That is grace. Amen. All right. So back to your outline. So the enemy of receiving grace is pride. B, recognizing and rejecting pride. I'm going to talk about this. Examples of pride. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13. Number one sign of pride, and I'll give you an example. Look at this. There is no temptation, or trial that has taken you except that which is common to man. Do you know anything you go through other people have gone through?
Yeah.
You know that? You know one of Satan's biggest lies is to get you to believe you're the only one? 1 Peter 5 says, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. In other words, you're not the only one going through it. But see, everyone thinks, you just don't have any problems. Really? Have a seat. I can cry with you too. Amen? He says, there is no temptation taken you except that which is common to man. But somebody say, God is faithful. God is faithful, who will not allow or suffer you to be tempted above that which you are able. But with the temptation, he always makes a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Back up to verse 12. Wherefore, this is powerful. This is the key, I believe, to finding God's escape. Let him that thinks he standeth or stands take heed lest he fall. Never think, I like to say it like this, never say, I would never. How dare. You know, I've done that in my life, and it's not been good. You know, I've learned. You know, the more you know how much mercy you've received and are receiving, and how much, the more you extend mercy to other people. Amen. Self-righteous people many times and judgmental, arrogant people are people who don't see their own need for mercy. Amen? So thinking you stand is the reason we don't take God's way of escape. The Bible says we're to be on guard. Things come at us. You know, so many times we wait. Oh, let me show you these verses. And I couldn't find them last week, but I got them this week. Go from the Message Bible, Luke 6:46. I'm going to go quick because we got a Luke 6:46 from the Message. Why are you so polite with me, always saying yes, sir, and that's right, sir, but never doing a thing I tell you? I love the Message. Next verse. These words I speak to you are not mere additions to your life, homeowner improvements to your standard of living. They are foundation words, words to build a life upon. Next verse. If you work the words into your life, you are like a smart carpenter who dug deep and laid the foundation of his house on bedrock. When the river burst its banks and crashed against the house, nothing could shake it. It was built to last. Next verse. But if you just use my words in Bible studies and don't work them into your life,
come on.
Isn't that awesome? If you just hear my words, or in church services or whatever, or in conversation or however, but you don't work them into your life, watch this. You are like a dumb carpenter who built a house, but he skipped the foundation. When the swollen river came crashing in, it collapsed like a house of cards. It was a total loss. Amen? Number one key or sign of pride is to never think that in your flesh you aren't capable of whatever. Always recognize your dependence upon Jesus. Amen? Because sometimes we think, well, I've been a Christian now. I know I've had this attitude. I should be far further along than this. Anybody else ever had that attitude? Yeah. I shouldn't have any issues, man. I should have it going on.
Yeah.
But let me tell you something about your flesh. It never is saved.
That's right.
It always needs mortified. That's why he says, pick up your cross daily. Luke 9:23. Amen? It's a daily thing. And what is your cross? It's not, you know, asceticism, beating yourself, doing all. It's looking to Jesus, recognizing that the strength isn't in you, it's in the one who lives in you. All right. So think and you stand. And an example. Let me show it to you. Daniel chapter 4, verse 29. Remember King Nebuchadnezzar, he had this dream? And when he started thinking it was him, watch this. You know, he had this prophecy of this dream. At the end of 12 months, King Nebuchadnezzar walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. Next verse. The king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? Next verse. While the word was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, the kingdom is departed from thee. Why? Because he started looking at himself. No matter where we're at in this world, Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. You know what that means? He doesn't just get you started and you have to figure it out from here. You need to keep depending on him. Mm-hmm. Something I'm seeking, and everybody say this with me, I'm seeking humility. And we're going to talk about it in a lot of different ways because, listen, if God's resisting me, I don't want to live in God's resistance and the light that's in me be darkness. And I'm thinking, what's up? Why ain't it happening the way it should? You know, maybe it's because I'm doing it my own way and asking God to bless my plans instead of getting his plan, which is already blessed. All right, go to the next one. I could talk about David too. David in 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 1, you know, the Bible talks about when, at the time when kings went out, David was sleeping. He was sleeping in all day, and that's when he fell into temptation. But if you read 2 Samuel 11, you read chapter 10, he had just had major victories. He was on a high. Things were going good. You know, many times success can almost be more dangerous than adversity because you start thinking, well, it's got to be God. Look how great everything is. No, there's never a place, hear these words, there's never a place in this walk where you and I get that we don't need to totally depend on him. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He helps you keep your faith in Jesus and out of you. All right. That's number one. Don't ever think you stand. Number two, you see it there. Pride is the refusal. We've talked about this one, to cast your worries upon the Lord. All of us are tempted with worries. But if I hold on to the worries, well, I'm just a worrywart. No, you're a very proud person. And God's resisting that. I'm going to show it to you in the Bible. Now, please don't let that condemn you. Say, hey, see, that's the chastisement of the Lord. Don't. Paul said, do I become your enemy because I tell you the truth? No, I'm trying to help you. If I'm the problem, that's a good thing because I can change by the grace of God. See, but I'm going to have to humble myself and say, you know what? You're right. All of us are tempted with worry. Paul said, with outward fightings, within were fears, 2 Corinthians 7:5. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 3, I was with you in weakness and fear and in much trembling. In other words, I'm dealing with things, but I have to learn to cast it upon the Lord. 1 Peter 5, look at this, verses 6 and 7. Pride is the refusal to cast your worries, your cares, your anxieties upon him. We all have worries come at us. I've laid in bed at night thinking, how are we going to do this? What are we going to do this? Have you? But I have to say, Lord, you care for me, and I'm giving this to you. This is your problem. I told you, Pastor Dwayne Sheriff, one time he came to the church. It was on fire. And he said, Lord, you got a problem. But he said, don't worry. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. It is God's problem. It is God's problem. Your problems are not your problems, they're God's. Now, I'm not saying some things aren't of your own making, and God may redirect you. See, this is another thing we got to get into. When I get into clothed with humility, I'm going to talk, we need to submit to what God says. If we constantly reject God's word and we wonder, I don't know why I keep hitting poles, I'm only driving in the side ditch. The road? Amen. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you, lift you up in due time. Next verse. How do you humble yourself? Amplified. Amplified, please. How do you humble yourself? Casting. Casting. Like throwing a saddle on a horse, the Greek says. Casting the whole of your care, all of your anxieties, all of your worries, all of your concerns, once and for all on him. For he cares for you affectionately and cares for you watchfully. Casting your cares upon the Lord is humbling yourself under the mighty hand of God. Amen. Notice he didn't say, if you have cares, you're prideful. He didn't say that. He said, when the cares come, cast them on me. You can't carry them. Even this, science has proved. Think of the word disease. Disease. You were not made to carry cares. He's your father. Now, he may redirect you and say you need to do some things different, but cast them upon him. Listen, I look at my life to the best of my understanding, where I'm at. I'm where he wants me to be. This is all I know. I judge, Lord, am I, this, listen, let me tell you this. If you're missing it, God will show you. So you don't have to walk around, oh my word, I got to confess every sin. What if I miss one sin? Listen, if you need to confess it, you'll know it. The Holy Spirit's faith, he'll show you how to get, so you're not letting it you know, Satan in any way. He'll show you. Isn't that awesome? You know, you can ask God and he'll show you. He'll show you cares and concerns. But if I refuse, see, we think holding on to our worries, cares, and concerns, we think that is being responsible. Don't we? You just can't not care. Well, no, I'm not saying don't be responsible, but I'm saying give it to God. I've done everything I know to do. That's all I can do. I have a philosophy. Here it is. Are you ready? I do the best I can at everything I do. I try. That's it. And that's all I can do. If the best I can do is not good enough, you'll have to get someone else because that's all I can do. And after that, I'm not worrying about it. But you got to cast those cares upon him. Look at that, the whole of your care. Psalm 55, verse 22, the Amplified Bible says, cast your burdens upon the Lord, releasing the weight of it. Well, I cast it upon the Lord. Well, cast it again. I declare this is yours, Jesus, not mine. You may have to do it a bunch of times, not for God, but for you. Hallelujah. Pride is the refusal to cast one's cares upon the Lord. It's basically saying, God, you don't care about me. Because it says he cares for you. Affectionately. Amen. Number three, pride is manifested, oh, this is a big one, in contentiousness, being argumentative, full of strife, offendable. You're an arrogant, proud person. The good news is you can change your mind. You can repent, change your actions, say, God, you're right, I'm wrong. Thank you. Proverbs 13:10, let me show you. King James. King Jimmy. Proverbs 13:10 says, only by pride comes contention. That's the only way it comes. You know, I was reading the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, commonly referred to as the love chapter. And it says, love is not, the King James says, love is not easily provoked. The New King James and the New American Standard say, love is not provoked. And I think, oh Lord, sometimes I'm provoked. See, that doesn't condemn me. It excites me. I can humble myself and say, God, you're right. Look out. Here comes more flooding of grace. How many want more grace? God's right. And if I don't agree with him, he's right. I'm wrong. I'm going with him. Amen? Even in our marriage, I'm thinking, I thought it was all her. I did. I think it's all her. She's wrong. She's argumentative. She wants to argue with me all the time. Amen. Mark, I'll give you a ride home. Come on, I'm talking where we live. Amen. No, it's me. Come on, Jen. Amen. But you know what I can do? I can say, God, you're right. If I'm provocable, if I'm touchy, if I'm all those things, I'm walking in pride. God resists that, and it's not personal. You know, gravity is a physical law and it works. And right now we're all enjoying gravity, right? Imagine if we didn't have gravity. Hey, how's it going? Right? But this same law that we're enjoying, if we walk off of the roof, it can hurt us pretty bad, right? And it doesn't matter if you're male, female, doesn't matter. The law works. That's what this is. God resists pride. Pride caused the fall of the entire world. Pride was Satan's sin. Pride's what entered in, and man said, I will discern what's good and evil. Pride is prevalent even in the church. I want more grace. Anybody else? Next week, I'm going to talk about being clothed with humility. That's what the scripture says. That's number three. Number four. Pride is the belief, well, we could camp on this one for 3 days. Pride is the belief that it is not imperative to continuously hear the new covenant. In other words, pride is the belief that you already got it. Look at, I'll give it to you for the sake of time. I'm going to give you some verses. You'll just have to look them up. In Romans 10:17, it says, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Faith doesn't come by having heard. The Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone. Jesus said that, Matthew 4:4. But by every word, rhema, fresh application of the eternally written word that is proceeding, present tense, out of the mouth of God. We need to continually hear him. Okay? But if you think you got it, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, if any man thinks he knows anything, it didn't say he didn't know anything. He knows nothing as he ought to know it. It's ongoing. I see stuff that I've seen many times and I'm thinking, oh my word, when did you put that in there? That's how powerful God's word is. The belief that you got it, you never get it, you just keep getting it. That means you got it. Get it? Okay? You just keep getting it. That means you got it. But if you think you got it, you don't got it. Get it? Okay. All right. So the belief that, you've already got it. In the Old Testament, they had to go out and gather daily manna. Remember that? And then on the sixth day, they had enough for 2 days because of the Sabbath. Let me give you another one. Go to Psalm chapter 10, verse 4. I'm hurrying, I'm flying, hang with me. Psalm chapter 10 and verse number 4. Watch this. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, his show, his outward, his face, the Hebrew says, or through anger is another definition of that Hebrew word. Through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. Do you know it's wicked when we don't seek God?
Wow.
Yeah, I'm letting that hang. That's a wow.
Yeah.
I'm going to let that hang. It's wicked to not seek God.
Amen.
I'm letting it hang intentionally. And God not being in my thoughts is wicked. Amen. I'm just telling you the truth. Don't, am I become your enemy because I tell you this is good stuff. This is grace teaching. Any grace that teaches you, bless God, you're good, don't matter how you live. Well, you know, God's not judging you based on your performance. I agree with that. But I'm telling you, if it leaves you where you are, it's not grace. Because grace will take you in your present condition and lift you up. Grace says, come up hither, Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. Talk about a rapture. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. It's wicked to not seek after God. And the result of that is God is not in his thinking. He doesn't even think about God. He doesn't even factor God into the equation. Can I give you an example? Is this too hard? I'm not trying to be hard. People will move across the country for a good job. But you know, oh, we're moving across the country. Why? Because we're going to Karis Bible College and we're going to it's a really good church out here. We love this church. Well, that must be a cult. But they'll do it for a job. What does God want? I say that all the time. What does God want? That's what I want. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. See, we want God's blessing, but they're in God's direction. You understand that? They're not doing my thing and trying to get God to come over to my thing. It's following him. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Amen. There's a difference. Okay. Jump down to number 5. Pride is seen in a self-righteous judgmental attitude. I'm going to do this one quick. Oh, my word. Pride is seen in a... We'll do this one. We'll probably stop here. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. Watch this. And I'll probably stop here, and then I'll finish the other two, and then we're going to get it probably into the other outline. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. Everybody know, leave this verse up here. Everybody knows this verse, right?
Yeah.
Judge not, and you won't be judged. You can't judge me. Na 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 na. That is not what this verse is saying. But don't people do that?
Yeah.
And there's two scriptures that the world knows, right? Judge not that you be not judged. And in 1 Timothy, drink a little wine. But that's not exactly right. Aren't those the two? You know, there's a few other verses in the Bible. Here's what he's talking about. Go to the next verse. For with what judgment you judge. Whoa, 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 whoa. He just told me not to judge. Now he's talking about what judgment I judge. So this must not mean, you know, you can't ever discern any situation. It doesn't mean that. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, it says, he that is spiritual judges all things or discerns all things. Now watch this. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. This is a law. And with what measure you met or the measure you used in your judgment, it shall be measured to you. Once again, this is a law. Next verse. A spiritual law. And why beholdest thou the mote or the speck that is in your brother's eye, but you don't even consider the beam that is in your own? What he's talking about here is being hypocritical in my judgment.
Yeah.
For example, if I judge Doug for liking the Browns,
yeah,
and I'm trying to like the Vikings or the Bengals, I mean, come on. That's called hypocrisy. No, I'm kidding. Sorry, tried to throw a little joke there. So why beholdest thou the mote that is in your brother's eye, but you don't consider the beam that is in your own eye? Next verse. Watch this. Or how wilt thou say to your brother, let me pull the mote or the speck out of your eye, and behold, you got a beam in your own eye. How am I going to see clearly to help him get the speck out of his eye when I got a red sequoia tree in my own eye? Right? Next verse. Thou hypocrite. He's talking about being hypocritical in my judgment of other people. That's what he's talking about. He's not saying don't judge. He's saying if you're hypocritical, the same measure you met will be used on you. Thou hypocrite, first cast the beam out of your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to help your brother. He still wants you to help your brother get the speck out of his eye. You see that? Next verse. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs. Leave this verse up here. Neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you. What this is talking about is when I'm hypocritical in my judgment, and I've done this in my life. I've been very hypocritical in the past in judgment and judging other people when I had stuff going on in my own life. And you know what it did? It opened up a door because I took that precious truth, that precious pearl, and I judged somebody else with it, and it opened up a door and it caused judgment to come right back on me. Not from God. It's a spiritual law. I see this. I mean, I know of a situation right now where somebody really came down on somebody else, you know, for this and that, and I'm not even going to go into detail. You'll have no idea. They're not from here, blah, blah. But and I'm telling you, all come back on them. When I'm hypocritical in my judgment and I judge you, listen, God wants me to help get specks out of people's eye. He wants you to help get specks out of people's eye. When you see something, you see your brother sin a sin which is not unto death, you pray for him, you see him sinning a sin unto death, go to them, try to help them, all those types of things. But if I got a log in my own eye, I'm being a hypocrite in judging them. He said, get that log out and you'll see clearly to help them get that speck out. If you don't do that, what you do is you become hypocritical in your judgment, and you take that pearl, that precious truth, and you throw it under the dogs, and it gives them legal right to turn around and rend you with the same judgment that you're judging someone else with. I said a lot there. You'll have to get a CD. But that's the truth. I see it all the time. When I'm hypocritical or when someone is hypocritical, listen, that's not where you want to go. And it's not God. Back in the late 80s, there was a minister that got up on TV and judged another minister for, I don't know, he had an affair. I don't know what all the details were. It's been a long, long time ago. But he judged this minister and said that guy was a cancer that needed to be excised or cut off from the body of Christ. Guess what happened? His sin was exposed not once, but twice. Was that God? No, it's a spiritual law. He took that precious pearl, thou shalt not commit adultery, whatever. He took that pearl and he put that brother on display. Instead, the Bible says, have mercy, because mercy triumphs over judgment. I believe it's James 2:13. Have mercy in your judgment. Why? Because we all need mercy. Yeah. Amen? I don't want to give Satan any legal inroad in my life. Do you? I want more grace. So humble yourself by being merciful in your judgment of other people and your discernment. And your goal always needs, let me show you one more. Go to Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. What are we looking at, Christian? Huh? We done? Okay, all right, I got two more. We'll pick them up on the next one. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, if someone's overtaken in a fault, watch this, restore such a one in a spirit of humility, of meekness, considering your own self, lest you also be tempted. Now watch this. The word restore there is a medical term. It literally means to reset the bone, not amputate. Yeah. I've seen churches where somebody did this, rather than extend mercy and help them through it, they put them on public display, they humiliate them, and the people, listen, God forgives, but a lot of times people don't. Yeah. And they hold that against you. That is not how you do it. And whenever you put somebody on public display and you humiliate them, you're opening a door for judgment in your own life. Not from God, but it's a spiritual law. Yeah. And it's wrong. It's wrong, man. We need to extend mercy. Listen, if someone's overtaken in a fault, I'm going to do everything I can by the grace of God to help restore that person. And one of the things I'm going to do, the Bible says, love covers a multitude of sins, Proverbs chapter 10, verse 12. Have fervent charity, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. It'll cover these things. Why? You don't want to expose somebody? Remember what Ham did to his father Noah? He was drunk. You know what he did? He exposed him. And that wasn't good. Amen? See, these are things we need to cooperate with the Word of God. Why? Because God's telling us how not to let the devil in. That's what the Bible says, where there's envy and strife, there's confusion in every evil work. If I operate in envy and strife and a party spirit and all that stuff where it's all about me, I may as well open the door and say, come on in, Satan. Yeah. Have a seat. You like a cup of coffee? We have a Keurig. That's what we're doing. We don't want to do that. Satan's a defeated foe. We need to keep him in his defeated position. Under the feet of the church. And we do that by humbling ourselves, recognizing pride so we can reject pride. If I see I'm a contentious person, I'm going to reject that. If I see that worry comes at me, we all have worry come at us, every one of us, every day. But I'm going to give it to God. This is your problem, Lord, not mine. Amen. Isn't that awesome? God, are you ready for this? God doesn't want you to worry. I tell people this all the time. You've heard me say this. When I was a kid, I never worried about finances. Now, I heard mom and dad worrying out loud many times. But I never did. But since I've been an adult, you know, I've had many opportunities and have taken many of them. But I'm starting to see that, no, this is your problem, Lord. I'm doing everything I know to do. If you want me to do something different or whatever, you'll show me. But in the meantime, this is all your problem. I trust your direction. I trust your protection. I trust your goodness. I know you love me. Amen. You know, the only reason God corrects you is because he loves you. I could get up here every week and say, oh, God loves you and you're just great the way you are. Just keep being hateful and hating people you're under grace. And your lives could fall apart. The whole time you are under grace, but you're not receiving grace. That's why it says you got to receive it. Continually receive it. And it will empower you to deny ungodliness, to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age or world. Amen? That's the grace of God. And it will empower you. Paul said, I labored more abundantly than they all. But it wasn't me. It was God's grace given to me. Amen? It says sin shall have no dominion over you. Why? Because you're not under the law, but you're under grace. If you're under the law, sin's going to dominate you. Amen. I'm going to quit. Praise God. We got a couple more. If you want to bring this back, fine, but we're going to get into